the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And we're going to use the same format we did last time. Where do you want the people, the public speakers, to sit at the end? And you can have a seat and relax. We'd like to still ask you to keep your comments to the 3 minutes. And if you spoke at an earlier one, would appreciate it if we could primarily focus on new comments and things we haven't already heard. That would be terrific. Who's first, Mrs. Coe?
Thank you very much. Joan Coe, 26 Whitcomb Drive. I attended the four-hour March 29, 2016 Board of Finance meeting. I was ashamed how disorganized and chaotic the meeting was conducted. At this meeting, the Board of Finance was required to hear and give guidance to both the Board of Education and Board of Selectmen on the budget expenditures that would affect the taxpayers. Absent were Jeff Blumenthal and Rob Pomeroy. However, Chairman Barbara Pettigee monopolized the conversation on a phone hookup, leaving no time for a review. Now the task is more daunting, with the state reducing the revenues to the town over $1 million, with more reductions in the future. Simsbury can no longer look to the state for revenue. We will be losing $1.5 million from the Hartford building, and revenues will decrease from the building bubble. The assumptions of the past must be revised. The 7% debt limit should be reduced to 5% or lower to reduce future expenditures. The expenditures in the CNR budget should be reduced, and private groups should no longer be supported with tax dollars. All the items that are maintenance expenditures should be placed in the operating budget. The town can no longer take money out of the general fund to pay for private organizations or maintenance projects. The golf course should be privatized with a management company with a track record to increase rounds and reduce tax dollars. The town can no longer manipulate the budget with creative financing by using the general fund to cover operating costs. Taxes will have to be raised if all expenditures are maintained, which will make Simsbury uncompetitive in the marketplace. Simsbury Airport has increased the hangars for planes. Why don't the plane owners pay property taxes to the town? When will the Ethel Walker School donate money in lieu of taxes? Since they use all our town resources, open space should remain open and left in its natural state to reduce future expenditures. Both the Board of Education and the Town of Simsbury must revise their budgets to reduce expenditures. The general fund should not be used as a slush fund. The Board of Finance must accept their fiduciary responsibilities to the taxpayers and hold the line with a 0% increase in expenditures. And all of my comments will be posted on Simsbury Patch, Twitter at Joan Coe, Simsbury Forum Topics, and the news feed on Facebook. Thank you for listening, and I hope I've given you some guidance.
Thank you, Mrs. Coe.
Thank you.
Who else would like to speak? Could you please state your name?
Yeah, my name is Mike Rinaldi. I live at 32 Pinnacle Mountain Road. I spoke here before, and my comments are mainly on how we can run this town more efficiently. I think the Board of Education's responsibility to the taxpayers is to see if we can get the biggest bang out of our buck. We have the 49th highest mill rate in the state of Connecticut out of 169 towns. We also have what is called an equalized tax rate. That means the governor decided that cars are mobile. They have wheels on them. You can bring them any place. So he said, you know, we can't have this business of people registering their car in the low-tax town. So what he said, well, it's going to be 32 mills no matter where it goes. And the Blue Book value is going to be the same no matter where it goes. So cars now have an equalized tax rate. And therefore, the high-tax rate towns get a little bit of a rebate. The low-tax rate towns don't get anything. However, if you have a house, your house is drilled to the floor by cement, which is embedded in the earth. You can't move that house. You can sell it, but you can't move it. The problem is, if I take my house and I put it in Greenwich, it's worth 25% more than it is in Simsbury. But their tax rate is 40% lower. Therefore, my equalized tax rate is cheaper in Greenwich than it would be in Simsbury. And Greenwich has an excellent school system. higher than Simsbury. So therefore, we have a problem in a town that has an excessively high equalized tax rate. And the problem is, how do we negate that? The problem is twofold. At the recent meeting of the Board of Selectmen, they said their budget should be 3.74%. And the reason was given was that, you know, we better increase it a lot this year because next year there's a probability that we can only raise it 2.5%. That's nonsense. You don't do that. Okay? That's like me when I worked as a resident in Boston at the VA hospital. And the chief said, we got $200,000 left over. If we don't spend it, we won't get it in our budget next year. That's the government for you. Well, the other thing is the Board of Education. Now, the Board of Education, we have a great school system. It's hard to come here and say something negative about the school system. It's an excellent school system. It's Schoolberry. We love it. We cherish it. We support it. But it has to be physically responsible. Its primary goal is to education children. Its also secondary goal is to make sure that they provide an excellent curriculum for the students. But they have a responsibility to the taxpayer. At one time, we were 129 out of 169 towns for per pupil expenses. And we still had a number one school system. In fact, we were in DRGA. The problem is, in the past 15 years, and the board, the data is here. You can look it up. It's online. In the past 15 years, we've had an increase in budget higher than the CPI, except for 1 year when the negotiation between the Board of Selectmen and the Board of Education combined their medical programs, and they got a $500,000 or so reduction. So they came out with a 1.02% increase, which was lower than the CPI. But for every year, for 15 years, the Board of Education budget has been between 33 and 50% higher than the CPI. We've had a total decrease in enrollment from 2001, from 5,200 to this projected year of 4,027. From 2011 to 2012 to 2016, 2017, there's a 520 projected decrease in enrollment. That's 11%. Can you believe the FTEs went up? That doesn't make sense.
Can we ask, we understand yep, that. We Can we that. Ask you to wrap up?
Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak tonight? You sure I don't want to prematurely end the public hearing? Everybody's had a chance? Nobody thinking about it and just waiting for the next person? Okay. Seeing no one else wanting to speak this evening, we're going to call the public hearing officially to a close.
I'll move to close the public hearing if we need to do that. Do we need to do that or just call it? Just call. That's fine.
Yeah. You know, before I do that, is there anyone that wants to reply to the comments? I didn't even occur to me that you might, but would somebody like to reply? If not, okay. Thank you. So we'll move on. We have a regularly scheduled meeting this evening, and I'd like to officially call that to order at, I guess it's 5:55. We've done the pledge already, so with everybody's permission, we'll skip doing a second pledge. The first item is minutes. And do we have a motion to approve minutes?
Who's that, sir?
The first one is the April 6th public hearing.
I so move.
Second.
Are there changes from anyone?
I don't have any.
Linda, anything?
Is Linda on mute?
Linda, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm sorry. It just takes me a second to find the mute button. Yeah, I didn't have anything.
Thanks.
Okay, I had The very last sentence, it would be on the top of page 2. The very last sentence currently reads, Ms. Pettigene reported that in order for the town to stay with the 7% debt ratio, the capital projects will have to get up to $7 million, but noted that only the current year's appropriations are voted on in a given year. What I believe I was saying is the capital projects, future year capital projects will have to be reduced by $7
million.
Okay. So I just want to make that clarification. Instead of we'll have to get up to, they have to be reduced. Okay?
Yep.
Anything else?
That's it.
Okay. So can we have the motion to approve as amended?
So move.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. And Linda, can we get
aye.
You? Thank you.
Yes, me too.
Thank you. The next one is the regular meeting on April 6th. Is there a motion to approve?
So move. Yeah, I'll move.
Okay.
Rob moved. You're second.
Yeah.
Okay. Any comment? Any changes?
I had one.
Okay.
On page 2, the first full paragraph, it was noted that $6,000 would be needed in year 2 of the purchase of the body cameras for licensing. And while this fee may increase through time, it currently reads no other incremental operating costs have been identified with the program. I think what was said was that the other incremental operating costs
are unknown.
Were not identified at this time.
That's more accurate.
Okay, good. Because we talked about a fiscal note and not knowing what the costs would be.
Okay.
So any I'm sorry. Linda, do you have any other changes?
Okay.
So I'll move the adoption of these minutes with that amendment change.
Second.
All those in favor?
Say aye.
Aye. Aye. Jeff?
Aye.
All right, I'm sorry.
And Linda voted aye also. Okay, minutes are approved. And next we have the tax collector here this evening to walk us through the suspense list. Hello?
Hello?
Would you be willing to come up and speak into one of the speakers that will help Linda hear you on the
Sorry,
phone?
Just came from exercise.
Good for you.
If you wouldn't mind, we have a
Colleen.
New member, and if you wouldn't mind, Colleen, just explaining what
we're
the doing
suspense
with
list.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's about $3,000, little more than $3,000 less than last year. And basically what these are accounts that are still collectible. All of the businesses, most of them have had notices. The warrant has been sent out. The marshal has been sent out on these also for collection. They've just ignored all of our notices. On the cars, everything has been turned over to a collection agency, and those also are either ones that have moved out of state or ones that just have not responded to us. So every year what we do is we put these into the suspense list. Like I said, they are still collectible, though. And if you see any names, if you know where they are, let me know.
Okay. So we need a motion to approve.
Can I just ask one? So by moving these into suspense, what does that do relative to our budget receivables? It's a balance sheet.
It's a balance
sheet. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
They're
going to
sit
you.
There until they're collected
yeah,
or written
it's 15,
off.
It's 15 years.
Okay.
It's still collectible right. for 15 years from the grand list of what, you know, from what the accounts are.
Good. Thank you.
And at that point, there's an impact when we have to write them off.
Yeah. Yep. They're still the same interest rate. That, you know, they're still paying the same 18%
okay.
and everything. Yeah.
And the lien is
placed on. When there's a chance, I'd like to ask a question.
Okay.
Liens are not placed on personal property or on cars. Liens are just on real estate. We do not put real estate in suspense. Only personal property and motor vehicle.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Yeah.
Linda, would you like to comment now?
Sure. I'm having a really hard time hearing the speaker. But I did have a question about if we vote to take these things, or, you know, to give her approval to take these off the list, what is there no further action to try to collect? Because I did look through the list, and I happened to notice that some of the names on the list are actually still going concern businesses in town. So why would we let them off the hook?
We are not letting
them off. I just wanted to understand that better.
Yeah. No, we're not letting them off the hook, Linda. We are still collecting on them. These have all been turned over to the marshal. He's also collecting on them. They're just pretty far behind, and every year we put the prior year one in suspense. We are still collecting on them. We're not giving up on them. Out of the list.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
That's all I needed to hear.
Okay. Yeah. No, we are never giving up. That's for sure. After 15 years, we do, but after that.
Okay.
Anyone else have any questions or comments?
No.
Can I get a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second. So moved.
And it's second. A motion to approve the suspense list in the amount of $63,320.26. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Linda?
Aye.
And I vote in favor too. Okay.
Do you want to sign this one and I can take this one to file with the town clerk?
Yep.
Okay, now I think we have an audience here to hear us talk a little bit more about the budgets. There's a couple things we wanted to do tonight, and one is talk a bit more about the capital, and another one is to talk a bit more about the timing. We had previously announced that we have a referendum tentatively scheduled for May 10th, and we asked, because of all the stuff going on at the state right now, whether we could have some more time to allow things to clarify a bit. Now, we have no guarantee that by the end of session they'll make a decision at the state, but hopefully at least we'll get the legislature's response to the governor, because we don't even have that piece yet. We do know that the governor impacted what we are planning right now by around $1 million. And what we'd like to do is consider, and I want to talk this through with the board tonight, consider moving the referendum and holding, we would then hold a third public hearing, because they're under the charter, we have to have public hearings within a certain amount of time of the referendum. So what this would do is we would move and have another special meeting to finalize what we want to put forward to the voters, and then the timing of the proposed referendum then would move to June. Can you help me with the dates?
Well, the latest you could have it would be June 7th.
And by June 7th, that would still allow the town to get the tax bills out and make all the requirements.
Correct.
Okay. So, and for the June 7th date, the time frame for the Board of Finance to meet would be May what?
Right. It would be May 23rd. You would need to pass and file a budget.
Okay. Did you have a question, Linda?
Nope. Sorry.
Okay.
Multitasking here.
So is there, and we still will talk some more about the budget tonight, but is there an appetite to consider giving ourselves more time to get more clarity from the state before we take action?
I certainly would support that. I mean, $1 million is a significant sum of money, and whatever the legislature is due to wrap up May 4th, I want to say.
Right.
So the hope would be that we would have the guidance we need by then.
I am very supportive of this move, Barbara. I think it makes a lot of sense for us to try to make a decision with more information, and there's no guarantee we'll get it, but if we can give ourselves more information, I think that's really critically important. I for one don't want to raise taxes, you know, just in case, and then have it turn out we didn't need to. But the flip side is I don't want to not raise taxes if we're going to get a huge hit from the state and then be left just before we head into a downturn in revenue from the Hartford with less in our pocket. So I think we're in a particularly precarious position, even relative to other towns that are facing the same unknowns from the state. But I think this is a wise, cautious move.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree. I, although I would like to talk further about what guidance or alternatives we have if, in fact, we do have to come back and cut the operating budgets. sort of level so that the two boards that are responsible for the primary budgets have some guidance rules. Because what we don't want to do is just wait, and then have to hurry around and thinking. And so to that end, I think we should think about the two particular items that seem to be in play are the same ones we identified early in the process as, well, certainly the sales tax, the municipal revenue sharing. It's about 500-600.
So I'm having a hard time hearing you, Rob, if you can speak up.
Yeah, I'm just saying that the order of magnitude, I support waiting, but I think that just based on the dialogue that the chances of there being some adjustment to the cut in the educational cost sharing is more likely than there would be in a change of heart on the municipal revenue sharing. It's just a risk. Yeah. A risk we identified early in this process is that taking away money that we never had is much easier to do than the proposal from Governor Malloy relative to cutting the richer towns more than the poor towns not on the ECS. So maybe as a board we can discuss if in fact the ECS is restored and we lost the, what is the number, Sean?
It's 775, but he only proposed cutting
well, yeah,
six.
He didn't cut it all. Right. It was like 600,000.
648.
Right. 648. So what would we as a board do if in fact that was the outcome? It would be easy to just go home tonight and have dinner, but I think it would be more helpful to everyone involved given that we're going to have to have a public hearing and either send direction to the boards or not to at least talk this through briefly tonight. And since I'm talking, I'll keep going and just throw out that, you know, at $600,000, does it maybe make sense to absorb half of that in increased taxes and half of that in direction back to the boards to find some operating budget sharing so that we lessen the impact of both? And we don't put it all on the taxpayers or all on the budgets that we've already carefully drawn up and discussed.
Okay. So I can build on that a bit, but why don't we first, since it sounds like we had agreement on one point, why don't we set the date for our next meeting and for the referendum? It sounds like there's unanimous support for moving the referendum to the June 7th date. And May 23rd, what day of the week does that fall on?
So, the trick here is the charter says you have to file a budget 14 to 21 days before you hold the referendum. So you have, there's a little bit of a window where you could still have this. The budget also, I should say, has to be passed by you, which typically happens in the evening, and then filed with the town clerk during regular office hours when the town clerk is open. So that does trigger kind of a second. So the point is, you know, the 23rd, May 23rd is a Monday. May 24th, Tuesday, is exactly 14 days before the referendum. I know this gets a little technical, because is it 14 days before, or do you count the day or not? Sometimes we try to be conservative to make sure we're allowing enough space. You know, I would say you can't have a meeting on, you would be unlikely you'd have a meeting on Sunday to file it on Monday the 23rd. I think we could agree. So working back, you could have the meeting, it depends, again, we don't typically have Friday night meetings either, but you have Thursday, May 19th or Friday, May 20th, in which case it could be filed the following Monday and you are good for a June.
So why don't we look at the 19th, Thursday night?
Thursday, 19th. Yeah. How does that work for everyone who's here's schedule?
I was just going to say, having said that, I'm going to be out of the country, so.
Okay, when won't you be out of the country?
I leave on the 12th, and I don't get back until the 25th, so it doesn't really matter.
So there's no way. Yeah, I mean, there is still, like I said, it is a window. We have 14 to 21 days. You could back it up, but obviously we're trying to get as much chance of having information as we can, then moving earlier doesn't really help that cause. So that's why I said the 23rd is sort of the last possible.
Okay. The 23rd also works, though.
If you had, you know, if you had a hearing on the 23rd and the meeting of immediately after, like we're doing essentially tonight,
right,
and I filed the budget the following day on the 24th, you are, again, exactly 14 days prior to the referendum.
Can I ask?
Inclusive of the referendum day. That's, again, I'm more comfortable a day before. We've never had real clarity on this one piece with the day.
Yep.
Is it prior to the referendum, in which case you don't count the referendum day? So I know it's a little technical, but
so if the, I can
one
just
day
ask,
clear is better.
The legislature is due to wrap up by May 4th, and this is perhaps a good issue for you, Linda. If the legislature does not finalize a budget for next year and a special session is required, when would that typically occur?
It can occur as quickly as the next day.
Okay.
It all depends on when they schedule it. I mean, it typically won't, because if they don't have it done on May 4th, then they've got some serious negotiating still to do. So it's hard to predict, but they will try to do it as quickly as they can, because, you know, July 1st is their new fiscal year, so they've got to get their house in order too.
Okay. Yeah, I'm just thinking, usually I it's June, isn't it, the time frame when they, I thought it was normally end of May or beginning of June, so I just.
Well, sessions sometimes end in May. They have short session, long session, so they sometimes end in June, and we remember sometimes budgets ending, like last year's ended in June.
In June.
Because it's a long session.
Special sessions, I thought
this happens to be a short session here.
Yeah. Well, keep in mind, too, this is an election year, so believe me, they're all anxious to hurry up and finish. They've got to get out, dealing with campaigns and such. So, the pressure will certainly be on them to get it done as quickly as possible. But there's no guarantee of exactly when things will happen.
Okay.
I'm just trying to figure out what I'm looking at.
So, what day are you back again? Not on the 23rd either.
No.
Okay. And Linda, when are you?
I have a question about the process on our end. Let's say they, at the legislature, complete it, you know, May 10th. Would we still want to wait all the way until the beginning of June to have the vote, or can we move the vote back forward and move it up?
Well, we have that 14-day minimum.
I know we want to give ourselves as much time as possible for the legislature to get done, but if they actually do get done quickly, do we want to then move it back up so that the town and everybody can get going on stuff?
We certainly can do that, Linda, but we have that 14-day period, so.
Okay.
Right,
we have
but
to
you
go.
Do have, but you, I mean, you could call a meeting. I mean, right. Again, you just, you're
as
not setting a referendum tonight. All you're doing is, we're working back from referendum, so you don't, I mean, you can set a, what you do need to do, because it's, you have to have a last hearing. You should schedule a final hearing. But you could move that, conceivably you could move that up. Again, it takes a motion, so
right.
I don't know how, I mean, a special meeting of some kind, but.
Yeah, okay, that makes sense to do if we can.
Never done it before.
So, Linda, when are you back in town?
May 16th.
May 16th?
Okay, so you'd be here that week.
When is our May meeting scheduled?
You have a regular, it's the third Tuesday, right? So I think May 17th would be your regular, I can look it up.
May 10th. Oh, no, that's the budget vote, May 17th.
Hmm? But I don't know, did you schedule a regular one the same month as the referendum?
I don't have a regular one in my calendar.
And then I think you only scheduled the May 10th as a regular.
Yeah, we don't.
So it'll have to be a special meeting.
Okay. So, for...
Do we want to go with... Well, do we want to... Well, no, we'll just not back it. Okay, never mind.
So the week of the 17th, either the 17th, the 18th, or the 19th, that's a Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday, from Linda and Jeff, can I get commitments on your schedules to be there? Does one look better than the other for either of you?
It all looks good to me. I can't seem to access internet in this room.
Yeah, but if we can avoid the 19th, that would be helpful, but I could be the 17th or the 18th.
Okay. Well, then let me throw out the 18th, if that seems to work for everybody. And we'll put it on the calendar for now. And as Linda said, if we have a miracle and there's a budget from the state earlier and we can move earlier, then we'll do our best to do that. Okay,
great.
So that just takes care of scheduling.
That'll be the public hearing date as well, right?
Yes, we would have another public hearing at that date. That's correct.
Okay.
Okay. Now let's go back to the conversation of what guidance we would like to provide tonight. Obviously, we've got the choice of putting 100% on the taxpayer or keeping the tax increase flat and going back to the Board of Ed and the Board of Selectmen and asking them to find whatever money is eventually cut. Everything I'm hearing is people are betting that it will be somewhere in the middle. So that $1 million number that we're hearing now, people are guessing it's not going to come in as high as that, particularly because it's an election year.
Right.
But again, we won't know till it actually happens. But a cut at this point on either of the boards obviously is going to be difficult because they all have worked very hard to get to where they are right now. Rob's proposal was, why don't we think about a 50-50 split and ask the boards to find something and everybody kind of contribute to this. I don't know, do you have any thoughts that you'd like to share, Jeff?
I mean, so we're looking at about 325,000 total if we were to ask them to go back and take a sharp pencil, well, right?
Yeah, there's one other aspect which we were going to talk about in a minute, which is how much do we cash spend towards debt service or capital projects? That's part of the same equation. The third element, there are two major budgets, and the third element is debt service / cash expenditure for budgets. And again, I preface this by saying that I expect it likely will be somewhere in the middle, and that was focused primarily on the loss of the municipal revenue sharing.
Right.
So would you like
I'm not sure if I understood everything that you just said, Rob, but just so I understand, if we are going to ask the Board of Ed and the Board of Selectmen to make cuts in their operating budget, can we also make cuts in some of the sort of capital stuff that was thrown onto the, or could they make cuts in the things that we were thinking might be paid for with cash? Would that also be helpful, or?
Well, we.
Does that not count?
Yeah, we didn't. Did we specify exactly where the cash was going to be spent? I don't think we did. What we said was, what we were discussing was increasing the amount that we would potentially cash spend to something like $6.5 to $6.6 million in the 2017 budget, so that we could help smooth the long-term curve of capital available and stay within the 7% target on debt service. All of that gets pulled back proportionally to any reduction in the budget. But here's my thinking: $600,000 round number. If we let's cut it in thirds. If we took $200,000 out of the $6.6 million debt service / cash for projects. We took $200,000. We asked the two major boards to find $200,000 collectively in reductions in operating expenses, and we increased the taxes by $200,000.
You said collectively, you mean each?
No. I'm saying that out of the operating budgets comes $200,000 from the combined town and Board of Ed and Board of Selectmen budget. $200,000. Increase in the mill rate more than what we had originally planned, and $200,000 in a reduction in capital, the debt service and cash. That's a total of $600,000. And then if we lose the full million, we'll either have to take it out of reserves or at the finish line adjust the mill rate further. But if we don't at least ask the Board of Ed and the Board of Selectmen to try to find that kind of, whenever we have the meeting, on the 18th, and we say, boy, they took it all away. We need to cut the budget, raise the mill rate, and reduce our cash budget. it doesn't feel right to me not to take some of it out of the expense side. And so if you can, if we could ask those boards to be prepared to find $200,000 out of these already very well vetted budgets, I think that's the reality that Governor Malloy is facing, we're all facing, you know, as the tax burden gets shifted back to the municipalities, to the towns. It's not fun. It's not pretty.
And Rob, I think we have to be more specific in that direction in terms of what share the Board of Ed versus the Board of Selectmen would each have to find. I mean, are you thinking pro rata or...
I'm a pro rata guy, so I mean, yeah. But it seems to me like, yeah, those the budgets are relatively 70-20. And I know that a large part of both of these budgets are not, are already locked down. I've been through all of that, but I'm talking about $200,000.
You know, the difficulty with the mill rate increase is that we only exacerbate the problem on a go-forward basis because we're looking at the 32 mill rate cap on cars, on personal property, and that's not being adjusted, as I understand, for inflation. So if we're not going to be held harmless in that in the future, we're only going to stand to lose more each year if our mill rate goes up. I mean, our mill rate would... be going up.
You're completely right, Jeff. We're just dealing with the 2017 budget.
Right.
We're staring at a 2018 budget in which we have reduction in income and reduction in reimbursement or sharing from the state. So all the more reason in my mind that it would be what I call whistling by the graveyard to do nothing this year, because we could probably suck it up with reserves if, in fact, we get hacked like that.
Right.
So
maybe this is a good point to walk through the sort of the last piece of the equation, which is debt service and capital, and take a look at, would you mind putting it up so we all have them in color graphs in front of us, but would it be possible to put it up on the board so people in the room could see it too? And Linda, did you get another set with them numbered? So if I refer to number one, you'll know what I'm referring to?
I did not.
Okay, then I'll read the header.
They didn't come.
Okay.
I think it was late last night.
No, a new set came in with the numbers.
About 4 o'clock, 2 hours ago.
Yeah, I got four of them that I talked to.
They're just
Sean
numbered.
About.
It would make it easier to talk to.
With Sean this morning, but I haven't had any since then.
I'll send. Yeah. Same as Linda, I'll send them again. I sent them just a couple hours ago. If you want to refresh, double check your email.
But otherwise,
hold on, I'll send it one more time.
And I don't want to jump into this until people have a chance to see.
You want to do just sort of maybe a 3-minute recess, and we'll get the, because unfortunately that has to be on that computer, so I have to.
Sean, if you send them now, put a different title on them so they don't get, you know, the dread thing that happens.
Will do.
Email.
Yep, no problem.
So what we've done this year, just for the audience's benefit of what we're about to look at, is we actually worked.
Oh wait, I found them.
We worked with the consultants. We're still thanks. Killing a little time for them to get it up on the screen here so everybody can see what we're looking at. We worked.
Yeah, I just found them. Sorry, I did.
We worked with the bond consultants, the financial consultants, and we actually took a look because we were so concerned about the size of not this year's. This year's is up compared to the last 4 years, but next year's is substantially up because they have on the capital plan, and this is all publicly available. There's a 6-year capital plan that's done every single year, and we knew that it would not stay within our 7% debt limit, and we wanted to work with them. And so what we did, which hasn't been done before, is we actually did cash flow projections for each of the projects and then worked with bond counsel to look at when would we actually go borrow the money. So when would the debt service begin and when would we have to start paying it back? And so we did new schedules looking across the 10-year period, because we normally borrow for a 10-year period, to understand what's available. And we also have had some conversations about how do we because we can't afford what's on the list. We can tell you that before we get to next year. Next year's is, and no matter how you look at it, at least $7 million too high, and maybe more than that, depending on what we decide to do this year. But we've run a bunch of different scenarios that just chart out what, given different assumptions and how we would approach the budget and tax increases for taxpayers, how can we afford the capital plan that's in front of us? And while I said we know we can't afford the whole thing, how much do we really need to reduce it by to make it affordable, stay within the 7% and minimize any kind of tax burden on taxpayers? So we're still charging it up?
Almost there.
Okay. So essentially,
John, did you, sorry to interrupt, did
no
you
problem.
Only just send one additional chart?
Yes.
Okay.
That's right, Linda.
Okay.
So as everyone knows, the high school was a very large project for this town, and when we went to bond that, it has taken us, we've actually been very lucky because interest rates have been very low, and it's been refinanced twice now to lower the debt service and get us in a better position. But that's hasn't fallen off yet, and that's the big project that we see starting to fall off. And of course, when that falls off, we don't have to pay debt service on that anymore. And then what we have is the opportunity to do new investments in town and stay within our 7% limit. Now, you always could have something come up that could create a problem and you need to go above it, but it needs to be something that we can't have planned for. And what we're trying to do on Board of Finance is smooth things and plan appropriately and minimize tax increases and tax swings from year to year. So the very first chart that just went up, everything that is black is already borrowed money. So it's the debt service we have each year on what we've already spent, so that's a given. What we have in the blue, there's two shades of blue and there's an orange, is new borrowings we would have to undertake to fund this year's projects that we'll be approving this year and next year's projects. Those are the two big years that are going to take up most of the capital for the next 10 years. So this first chart is just showing you debt service only. This, and Linda, that one, I think it's number one on your package. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay, so that's the one that just got sent today.
Yes. Number two.
Sorry, we're having a technical difficulty.
Well, one looks good.
I know. It's not responding. It's telling me to click it. Give me 1 second. I'll try that.
So I didn't get one that was numbered number two. I only have one chart, and it's number one.
Okay, the number...
Oh, sorry. Cancel
page.
That. I just found that. Technology. Got it.
So number two is a chart that in the meeting that Mrs. Coe referred to where she thought I was talking too much, I was trying to explain these charts and what we had tried to do, because we actually as a town have never done this before, is look out and chart the five-year plan to see how it fits and different ways we could approach it. What we did on this chart, which is the one that was handed out at the meeting, and he'll get it up in a minute, is we said, what if we go to the 7% today? So in 2016, which is the current year that we're in, our budgeted debt service is actually 6.1, and what we did is we labeled it capital/debt service, and for some of the projects that are happening this year, so already approved, we're paying cash for some of those, and that's that green piece at the top. So when we talk about paying cash, the town still approves them, they go through the budget process, and then instead of choosing to bond that portion, and it's about $500,000 this year that we're paying off right up front. It's like if you can pay cash, then you don't have to borrow it and bond it, and it makes it other things more affordable in the future if you're not building up. If you can pay cash, it's a better way to do it than to pay bond counsel and bond fees and interest rates on projects. So what I did at the last meeting was say, if we were to go up to 7% beginning now, to give us some more room to be able to afford that, how much would I still have to cut what's in front of us? So what we were looking at was getting to the number to tell the Board of Selectmen and the Board of Education how much that we knew next year's numbers were just too high. And this is, if we had a tax increase to cover for next year to bring ourselves back up to a 7% debt ratio, and it's worth about, it's a quarter of a mil? Is it worth little, between a quarter, a little higher?
Yeah.
0.26. So it's close to a quarter of a mil increase if we were to jump to that this year, but what for next year's budget that we're working on. But what that would do is once we're at the 7%, if we just stayed there, you see by that third year over 2019, we won't have borrowed yet on the new projects that are coming up now because there's really a delay in municipal projects from when you start, when you approve them to when you actually spend the money and bond them. So we'd have 1 year where we'd be taxing to actually pay cash for those and be smoothing out the line, which would allow us, which would still require, you see the two years that are over that line, that would require a cut of, what was that one, about 7 million to, of the projects in next year's plan to make that us stay on that 7% line. So that's showing you that we would have a problem next year, even if we raise taxes this coming year and go up to the 7% right away. So this was what we thought was the best case. We didn't say we were going to do it. We hadn't made any decisions, but we just wanted as a board to understand how it all fit and what it meant. So that's the second chart. Then the third chart is we've had a lot of discussion about trying to hold down the tax increase next year. And what the third chart does is it keeps us flat this year, next year. It still generates cash to pay for some of the projects. You'll see that there's still a little bit of green, but we're not increasing it even a penny over this year's. We're going to hold it flat, so there's no increase. And what it does do is increase it up to 7% in the following year. And this set of assumptions, you could run a million of these charts, but that's how we ran it, thinking, okay, if we don't want to increase next year, we're going to have to go up to 7% sooner or later. We don't have a choice in that. That's what you saw in the very first chart. If you're going to bond for these, it's going to be way over. And I didn't mention it, but on the first chart, we were over by $14 million. So if we didn't start to bond for, start to approve some of the capital right now in cash, and that very first chart, and all we did was play debt expense, we'd have to actually reduce $14 million next year's capital plans that are in front of us. So this particular one just showed what it would look like if we delayed it a year. And that basically doesn't do a ton. It's $7.5 million would still have to be cut. So we're really only changing 1 year. And then the fourth one is one where we said, okay, what if we held it flat, no tax increases to pay cash, and we're going to only increase it when we have to pay the debt service. And what you can see, if we were to do that, we would not have to increase, we're at 6.1 million. It's just a coincidence, it's around 6% too. But we're at 6.1 million, and that's because our budget's close to 100, so the percentages and the dollars come out pretty equal. We would hold it flat until 2019, and then by 2020, you'll see the blue, is that's a borrowing we'd have to do. That's a new bond offering that we'd put in the blue, and that would actually cause the increase in tax at that point in time. And then, as you can see, there's a lot more now above that 7% target line. So to make this work, in next year's plan, we'd have to be cutting a little over $10.5 million out of next year's plan. And then the last one was a scenario that I call this one Linda's scenario. She basically said, let's stay flat for next year so we don't have to have a tax increase. But then why don't we keep it at that percentage? So we're at 6.35, is that right? 6.56, thank you. We're at 6.56 now, so we're down below our 7 target. What Linda said is, what if I say I want to stay at 6.56 and I never want to go back up to 7%? What does that do to my capital affordability? And of course, this last page shows you'd have to cut almost $18 million of projects out of next year, this year. Because those are really, the first 2 years are really big, and they're what's causing this tail. Now, you can see you're way below the 7% target in the outer years. So some of this is a conversation about delaying things, but you're delaying them substantially. We're talking about authorizations for 2016 and 2017, and you can see you don't have availability until 2024. So you're talking about a very substantial time frame to wait if projects are being delayed till there's affordability again. So I wanted to walk everybody through these, and I know I talked a lot again, Joan. But I'd like to ask the board, I think this is kind of complex stuff that we've never done before. Do people have questions about what it's trying to show, or scenarios that, you know, they would be interested in seeing that we haven't presented?
No, I get
Barb, it. Just one clarification I'd ask for.
Yep.
In each chart, basically the year 22, 23, and some additional years, are where you're above the target line. And that amount above is, just want to make sure I understand, is what you're saying in the title, where we'd have to cut X million dollars, that's what it would take to get rid of that amount that's above the line?
Correct.
Okay.
That's correct. That's what it would take to stay within our 7%. And you're not cutting the appropriations in that year because of the lag. You're really cutting appropriations beginning. And it could be this year, and that's why we've had the conversation earlier, and this board initially did not show an appetite for pushing back on this year's capital. But it's 10.7, is it, in this year? So again, this is a much bigger year than we've had for the past few, and it's what it's doing in effect by timing is putting everything this year as a higher priority than what we're starting with next year. So anything that gets approved this year isn't on the table for conversation when you start to look at the junior high and some of the other big projects in next year's budget, which is why we thought it made sense to look at the 2 years together once we knew that this was going to be a problem beginning next year.
Yeah, and I think that's a really good point, because I wonder if the two boards, knowing that, okay, if we're inclined to say, okay, well, we're going to have to cut something significant next year, would they actually rejigger what they're asking for this year so that they'd have more room next year for something they consider higher priority next year? And I think we want to give them that option.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a good idea, Linda, but the real impact of the very large dollar projects that need to be bonded for. That really is the case.
Well, there's multiple things. So it's whether or not we're going to ask the taxpayers whether we're going to use cash and pay off some stuff as we go, and that has to be smaller projects, right? That can't be the big ones. So the big ones are going to have to get bonded. Because essentially the way you do a bond authorization is it's for all or nothing. So we'll have to work through. When we approve the budget, we're going to decide this year which projects we would like to put into capital and which we would not like to. And whether or not he's back on this chart two, no, chart, yeah. Well, no, the next one where we hold the first 2 years, thought, yes. So even if we don't increase the budget to pay for more debt, we still have a capital piece that we already know is built into the 2016 budget. And that's that little piece of green at the top. So the difference between the two charts is whether we go to that 7% right now, because we're going to get there if we're going to do these projects. It's just when. And if we go now, then we create a little more affordability. Is that the appetite of the town and everyone? And that's really what this is just trying to demonstrate.
Can I ask a question? The capital projects that go to the voters that need to be specifically approved, that amount is set by the charter, correct? It remains the same?
It's based on a percentage spending, yes.
Based on the percentage spending. And so that is what amount right now? It's the
1%
of total budget.
They individually go
to
the voters.
Any singular project. So So roughly $1 million, $100 million. And Well, I like the idea of smoothing over the budget over time. I guess I'm also thinking that you want to give voters the opportunity on some of these projects to weigh in, should we get that far. And it's hard to know what the appetite is. I mean, I think the two biggies, right, are the $22 million for Henry James. That would be over a period of time, right? It wouldn't be all in year one. And we would expect to be reimbursed a portion of that by the state. But that's a $22 million hit. And then I think the senior center is about $8.2 million are the two big hits. And I think those are going to be some discussions that are going to need to be had within the community, and there's going to be a lot of there could be a lot of dissension within the community as to whether the community wants to spend that kind of money. So when we look at the capital projects in the horizon, we talk about needing to cut out $14 million or $18 million. If one of these gets rejected, it absorbs it pretty quickly.
Yes. But so people understand, we only approve this year's, even though we go through this exercise every year. That's why nobody's ever actually laid it out so we could look at it. The reason that we did this year is because this year's number's up a lot from prior years. And so the more that this year number's up, the less you have for the next year. And that's really all I wanted
everyone to see. Next year's number really spikes up.
Absolutely.
Yeah, oh, my God.
Absolutely. Yeah. So we're not approving next year. The school is not, Henry James is not ready for discussion. It's not coming before the voters, nor is the senior center this year. It's just not ready. But if they both hit on the same year, we can already tell you that we're not going to be able to fit them both in. And that's what we want to make sure everybody understands right now.
I wish we had a better sense of where the voters are. I mean, there was a survey that was conducted, I want to say, on the senior center where I don't remember the precise results, but I thought there was greater consensus around spending. Lisa, maybe you can...
5 or 12, but not 8.
Right, 5 or 12, but not 8. And so, 5 or 12, but not 8. And on the $22 million for the middle school, I don't know what the appetite is for climate control and the like if it goes to the voters. I don't know. Some of it is not like mandated by state statute. Some of it is not a safety issue. And there are some there are things that we need to be addressing. Clearly, there are others that if you had to prioritize, some might be viewed as, if it was your own household, perhaps more of a luxury versus, whether you have central air conditioning or whether you sweat it out. I don't know. I mean, I'm not going to say when I was a kid, because I know that, today's world is different. I'm sorry, Linda, you were going to say something.
No, I'm just giggling.
So did that help putting that in at this point? Because I think that's a piece of our discussion, too. Do we want to make a decision at this point about whether or not, we want to cause a tax increase to go back up to the 7%, or do we want to hold it flat for another year? And I guess, I know I'm talking a lot, but the other piece that people may not have heard before is we are anticipating some difficulties next year. We're anticipating a second cut in the car tax mill rate, and we're anticipating the Hartford property not generating taxes at the level it's generating this year and not being able to make that up with other taxpayers. So we're anticipating $1.5 million hole for the Hartford and another $500,000 potential hole associated with the car tax reduction, the second car tax reduction. The state could make us whole for that, but we do have a governor that likes to pick on wealthy communities, and I don't know whether we will be made whole or not. There's been no promise for that second piece of it. The cut may be retracted, so we don't have to go down to that. I don't know. But all those are unknowns that we'll be facing next year. So we were starting next year worrying about a $2 million number, and that's part of why we're managing reserves. And when we say cash, we're basically paying out of reserve levels, which when we budget cash, then we know we're budgeting to use it for that. But otherwise, we're paying down from existing reserves to be able to smooth in some of that. And that is our current plan for absorbing the Hartford next year so that there isn't a spike. Because they will fill in with other projects a couple of years down the road. So we need to just make it okay for the taxpayers during that interim time while we've actually lost the Hartford revenue. And we, as a board, have already talked about using reserves and managing that process to keep the tax increases down during that time frame.
If I could just say, Barbara, for the, I guess anybody's watching on SCTV, the I believe the estimate was around 12.93% on reserves right now, and our our policy that we revised last year was intended to utilize the amount over the 12% to accommodate these kinds of fluctuations, the loss of a large taxpayer, and it's one of the examples cited. So while our range is 10 to 12%, the plan at this point is to now use that money to soften the blow of the loss of a major taxpayer while we build the tax base back up with the new development that's coming online.
Right. Okay.
Lisa has a question.
Oh, Lisa.
First of all, thank you for your analysis. I think it's really helpful to sort of plan long term and think about these things. The things I just wanted to, you know, offer as part of consideration, as we look at the charts, there are a lot of assumptions baked into that.
Can you wait 1 second? Can you hear Lisa, Linda?
No, not at all.
Would you mind?
You want to just come on, just come sit by me if you want.
Yeah. Thank you.
Hey, Lynn, can you hear me?
Yeah, thank you.
So one of the things, I think you guys did a great job, and in doing this, it required making some assumptions. And some of those assumptions, as we think about the CIP, the plan itself is literally just a plan, and we just approved projects right in the first year. So some of the assumptions, I just want to give caution to that they may change. For one, for example, is that 7% target is a moving target. If inflation goes up, that line will go up, because you can't have inflation going up and only increase 2%. I believe the assumption is an increase in 2% of budgets as we go through that. Is that right, Sean?
It is, but we're hoping that we stay close to that 2% number.
Right. So, but I'm just saying, you know, if inflation goes up to 3%, that's, if you want to maintain assets and services, that's not, that may be one assumption that might change. Another assumption baked in this is bond rates. Another assumption baked into this is cash flow, and then of course projects. When we do our CIP planning, and I think Jeff can speak to this, we put out numbers that we think are close to what, but they aren't accurate, and we get more refined as we get closer to the year that we're looking to approve. So when we look at this and say it doesn't fit, I don't think that's entirely accurate. We don't know yet, because the CIP is just a plan, and it contains some estimates that get refined as we get closer to the time of the project. And some things fall off the priority list, or something comes up that we hadn't anticipated that we have to move into a new priority and things get shifted. So I just want to point out that when we do a plan, it is still literally just a plan, which is why we only do projects any one given year. The other thing I just wanted to point out, because interest rates are so low right now, if you're going to build, you want to build when interest rates are low. You don't want to build when interest rates are high. I know that's sort of counterintuitive, but you do want to build when you're in a position to do so financially. And right now, with our AAA bond rating, we are in a financial position to do what we need to do that's in the town's interest. Now, that said, we don't want to overspend. You're exactly right. And we do want to be mindful of this. But I think it's also important to keep in mind where the interest rates are and when do you spend. Because what you don't want to do is say, put off all these projects. Interest rates go up, and now you can't do any of the things. Part of the reason you have the 7% number, as I understand it, and Mike Long is here, and he was one of the people that helped set that way back when with Kevin Kane, is that's also very close to what it is asset depreciation over time. So our assets depreciate between 6 and 7% a year. So you do want to keep the capital projects up to that level so that you're maintaining your assets, because what we don't want to do is get behind in maintenance of our assets. So those are just a few comments I put out there.
So would you actually advocate that for a higher than 7% target, you're saying?
No, I think, you know, 7% is your guideline, and we can do that. I'm just saying that the projects, as we fit the projects in there, they're guesstimates. And the cash flow are guesstimates, because as Jeff can tell you, and where's Burke? Burke can tell you, as you do projects, sometimes you need I mean, they guessed when they did the cash flow, we think we're going to need this amount this year, we're going to need this amount this year, but sometimes the cash flows are when you need the money changes as you get into the project. So I just say, when we look at this chart, it's not hard and fast.
No, it's absolutely not.
It's an estimate, it's a guideline. So that's my only question.
Oh, did you unplug yourself there, Sean?
No, I think it went to sleep.
Oh, it timed out.
So you could go up or down.
Well, and what's important to know, though, are those years are caused by this year's, the 2017 and the 2018. So we're not going to actually spend that money or bond that money out until 2022. We're going to start to bond some of it in 2021, but this basically shows you bonding it out in those future years. So the projects would have to come down, and you're right, cash flow could move a bit, but it's not going to change the story significantly.
Well, one thing that might, which this board has considered in the past, is when you bond school projects, which are fairly significant, you have done 15-year bonds.
Yeah, and we looked at that. We didn't want to present it yet because we think it makes sense to try and manage to this number if we can.
Absolutely, but I just wanted to put it as an option. So not all the options are cut capital. Some of them are cash flow. Some of them are how you bond, which tranche you do.
No matter what we did and how we ran it, you still had to cut the capital. Nothing we could come up with, even using 15-year, would afford the projects in next year's budget. So we know that, and that's why we wanted to share it with you guys now.
No, and I appreciate that. And that's what we use the following year to plan, is how we do that. I think Matt has, did you have your hand up?
I was going to ask that question, and Barbara and I have talked a little bit about that before. Rod, you mentioned it really is the big project. High school was not a 10-year bond.
It was a 15.
So would we be willing, when the time came, we hardened up our pricing a little bit as we come forward next year and talk about it, to potentially at least model that out and have that discussion so we can see what it looks like.
Yeah. If we can just run through, I appreciate Lisa's perspective on this, and I think you're right in many regards, but I think the important takeaway, another important takeaway here is that, let's go back to slide one, where we don't use cash as part of, you know, just to stay with a strict debt service. We just use the 7% as it relates to debt service. We're going to have a benefit in 2019 of reduced debt service. And so the question really is, you know, should we bond ahead of that just so we smooth that curve, or should we in fact look at options to start spending cash alongside actual debt service? And I think this board seems very willing to do that. So then what happens is now we go to the alternatives to do that, which are basically slides 3, 4 and 2, 3, 4 and 5. One is, so if you look at 2, if you're going to take that tack, then you would have to raise taxes and spend right up to the 7%. So that's an aggressive Board of Finance position on slide 2. Second would be, what's slide 3? Is
waiting 1 year.
Is what?
Waiting 1 year.
Oh, hold flat for 1 year. So that's a slight variation on slide 2. And then on 4, we hold it flat forever.
Until we have to
raise, and so that's an option to do the same kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And to Barbara's point, it exacerbates how much has to be taken out, regardless of when the projects happen. And then there's the Linda compromise, the Virginia compromise, which is to say, you know, we've been comfortably at 6.5% or so below our 7% target. Why don't we stay on that track? And that would require a modest increase in 2017, or maybe not at all, but that we would keep that curve sort of smooth. So I think that's the decision that we're going to talk about, not whether we do anything or nothing, but the question is, how aggressive do we want to be? And I would like to have this discussion in conjunction with knowing where the whole budget sort of comes out and relative to expenses. But I'm in favor of Linda's compromise as a good way to do it.
That means $20 million comes out of next year's budget.
$20 million?
17.7.
I just want to clarify, this is not actually what I was proposing. Oh. I wanted to know what was sort of the worst-case scenario. That's why I asked for this, not because I was proposing to do this.
I
proposed compromise.
Yeah, sorry, Linda. It was just your idea that we look at it this way, too.
Right. So, I like, what's the worst that it could be? And cutting $17 million seems pretty onerous. But I wanted to know what would be outside for parameter.
I'd be interested, I mean, Lisa spoke, I don't know, either Burke or Matt, maybe to talk a little bit about just the Board of Education perspective as just in advance of our next meeting. I guess I'd like to get a sense of, from your capital project perspective, what are your thoughts in terms of if we have to come forward and say you got to cut X amount out, what are you...
I don't know what X amount is, so I want to know what X amount is. I'd want to have time to talk, honestly, to, you know, engage in the conversation with our board. I don't have a list to kind of prioritize tonight.
But are there certain... Can we just go back to that, though? I mean, in this case, I think I agree with Lisa's position, which is it isn't that you have to cut $17 million out. It is if you never want to go above the 7% cap or always stay at the 6.5% cap. I think that we need to do something today relative to using the cash to help us for that hole in 2019 and then see how these things play out and at the time make the decision as to whether we want to go above the 7% cap or we want to bond a big project of 15 years. Or we want to stagger the two major projects that are on the table today, and say we can do one in 4 years and another one 4 years after that, as opposed to just saying that this would be disastrous as it relates to next year's budget. I think the difference between slide 5 and the most aggressive plan that the Board of Finance would take, which is slide 2, is how much in the 2017 budget? It's about $500,000.
$464,000.
Okay. And so that's the decision we really need to deal with today.
I think not.
I put it on the table early in relative mix of operating expenses and raising taxes.
So that's $200,000.
Can I ask you to say that again more slowly so I can hear? Because I think what you were saying was basically we need to make a decision of whether to spend $500,000 now, as in slide 2, or wait a year, as in slide 3, and not spend that $500,000.
Right. That's what I'm saying. That's the decision we have to make. And that decision is a $460,000 decision that will impact how much we have to raise the mill rate and put that on the taxpayers. Which will be in conjunction with any kinds of information we get between now and the May 18th meeting relative to revenues from the state lost or expenses that we can cut.
Would the board entertain a question from the public?
I think that you crystallized this question very well in that, and that I agree with you that it's hard to make this decision about the capital without knowing what's going to happen with state revenue. Did we have to raise taxes substantially to make up for a big revenue loss from the state if that were to happen? And I don't think that it's going to be as big as we fear, but you never know.
So
I'm hesitant to raise taxes for both purposes in the same year. I mean, my concern is always that for our residents, that every time we raise taxes, not only do they have to pay the tax higher than other towns now, but then they also get hit on the back end when they try to sell their house, because their house ends up being worth less because their tax rate is so high. And I think particularly seniors, I mean, and I've heard this from a lot of them, they're really concerned about that because their house is their biggest asset, and at some point they're going to need to monetize it. And, you know, they need that asset to be worth as much as it can. So I'm not real happy about raising taxes in general. On the other hand, I want our town to have the kind of infrastructure that it needs. So it's easier for me to swallow an increase in the mill rate to accommodate the capital budget if we don't have to simultaneously do it to accommodate state cuts in revenue.
So can I just for perspective, Sean, do you have that chart that we used at the last public hearing? How much is, I know we ran it, the governor's increases, how much of a tax increase? If the whole million came in,
yeah,
how much?
That's what I was going to do. Yeah. Let's take a straw vote as if we got all the money that right. we had expected on the budget. Would
so,
we? What would we, as a Board of Finance do?
Right. So
it's your calculator, your mill rate calculator.
So, well,
you have the mill rate calculator? Or you
no, you can just do, so what would help, I think,
yeah,
is if we just know, if we went with the budget the way it is and there's no cuts, and the only thing that we're deciding on right now is to fund that extra green in next year's money, that is worth how many dollars and what mill rate increase?
So we're doing the reserve projections?
Yeah. Yep, exactly.
It's like half a mill, right?
It's like a quarter.
Yeah.
And then the governor's $1 million because it's twice that much.
So half if we're going to smooth out the mill.
Yeah, it's like a half. So it would be like a point and a half. But it sounded to me what I heard Linda saying was her opinion is if we get any cut from the governor that we know we need to swallow, then we should not fund the capital for next year. That's what I just heard her say. And I think we can make a decision like that tonight and be in better stead for the next meeting. Yeah,
well, no, the 435 is the number right there.
Yeah, but I thought... This case?
I really think the mill rate calculator...
0.21 mill rate.
Yeah.
And a 0.05% increase.
It's easier too, yeah.
Right.
I mean, it's easier to see it on the. I can bring up the mill rate.
So it's a 0.21 mill rate increase for 435,000. And that is a mill rate increase of 0.57.
Yeah, I'll pull up the mill rate.
Okay. And then the governor's amount, which we talked about, was another 1%, right? That $1 million.
Yep.
So what people are guessing is that it won't be as dismal as the governor's numbers. It'll be somewhere in the middle. So you're probably in that range, which now we're talking about. Your proposal was split it a third, a third, a third.
Right.
And that concept would get around 200 out of Board of Ed, Board of Selectmen, operating budgets, and the proposal I heard was roughly 150-50. So 150 out of Board of Ed, 50, you were Mr. Proportional Man, and 50 out of Board of Selectmen.
Fair enough.
So that's kind of the conversation that has all been on the table tonight.
I thought you said it was proportionate, right?
Yeah.
So
well, I said it's like 70-20, the other
right.
10% is everything else.
So doesn't that come out to be about 150-50?
Sorry, I'm not hearing you.
150.
Yeah.
Okay, I thought you said 50.
No. $150, $1,000, yeah. And $50,000.
You know, I don't mean to stray. I'm struggling because I'm just trying to think about this longer term and trying to predict the future. And when I think about, you know, bonding over 10 years and then we went 15 with the high school, you know, I guess I'd like to have a better sense of what the differential is in borrowing costs when you go from 10 to 15 and then even from 15 to 20. Because if you think about a senior center, for example, if we build a senior center, that's a capital project that I would imagine would be.
Yeah, I think that's beyond the scope of this meeting tonight, Jeff.
It is, but
I get why you're asking it, but I think the reality is if what we're trying to do here is make a decision whether we kick the can down the road at least a year relative to
$500,000 worth of a head start on a $30 million worth of capital projects. So.
Right, but if you were to bond certain projects over a longer period of time, it would have less impact on that
charge. And I think there's the potential to bond them in a way that doesn't have level debt service, for instance. I think there are other ways to skin this cap, and I think those are going to end up being more discussions around specific projects and how we finance them that are not, we're not capable of talking about tonight. Right. We don't have any facts about that. Right.
Well, so, and it doesn't impact what we're talking about right now, which is the decision
on what
do we want to do with the governor's cut, and what do we want to do for next year on capital.
Yeah, so I think, Linda, I'm just trying to move this along, but I think what you're saying is that we should, as a board of finance, be prepared to put the full $435,000 that we want to increase debt service in to the 2017 budget on the table for discussion relative to what we end up having to do with the mill rate. Is that what you're saying? That if we have to absorb some lost revenue from the state budget, that we would, I proposed basically half of it, a half pro rata kind of guy, but I heard, so I'm asking, Linda, was your proposal that we not do any of it if we have a mill, if we come back and?
Well, I guess I'm seeing it in terms of, taking the two things combined. So, if I'm willing to see the mill rate go up a half a mill for purposes of either covering the governor's cut or covering an increase in capital or some combination of the two, if the governor's cuts are not very big, then we could do more on capital, but kind of capping the overall amount that we're going to increase. And so if the governor's cuts turn out to be tremendously large, then we don't do the capital. If they turn out to be non-existent, then we do the capital, but that we kind of put a limit on how big of it we're going to pass on to taxpayers. Does that make sense?
So if the worst case were to happen, and that is everything we're talking about, we were decide to pass on to taxpayers, not ask for cuts and not cut anything, the impact is 0.73 mils. That's the chart I was looking for before. Thank you.
So if we lost the full...
From governor's cut.
This is the governor's. If the governor's is worth a half a mil, 0.52 mils, the $1 million cut. And that would cause Simsbury to have a 1.4% tax increase. If we were in a vacuum, if none of that happened and we got completely refunded, we were still going to discuss what are we going to do about debt service given the scenarios in front of us, and that is worth 0.21 mils, so 0.2 mils, and that's a 6% tax increase, 0.6% tax increase, so less than 1%. And if all were to happen together, now you're up to the 0.7 and it's almost a 2% tax increase, which is a big tax increase.
Yeah.
So that's why we're talking about how do we share the pain. And we're saying you used a number of 600 because we think the governor won't be able to cut the full million, but we don't know that for sure.
Right.
And so we do need to give guidance, I think, to Board of Ed and Board of Selectmen tonight. And I think we do need to make a decision on if we do get a cut equal to the debt service capital or greater, then we don't want to do that this year. And I think I'm hearing everyone say that, but we can just make that decision. And that's one more thing decided. Jeff, have you had an opinion on that?
I don't want to see us attempting to do both at the same time. I think it's just too much of a hit, and I think to Linda's point, I've also heard from many taxpayers and seniors who are concerned about home sales and the adverse impact of the mill rate, even though we can argue that we're superior to so many other towns and offer amenities and services, but reality is what it is. So, mm-hmm. you know, unfortunately, you know, we don't often hear at these meetings as much as perhaps we might from all constituents. I mean, I'm disappointed we have a public hearing tonight and we only had two people speak.
Well, there'll be one more chance.
Yeah.
Can I ask one more question just before we get off this? And I this was a helpful slide because I didn't, the perspective is that when, do you have the slide where we don't put in the increased debt service and we get the full $1,088,000?
It's a zero increase.
Zero mill rate increase.
Correct.
Zero
tax increase.
Zero tax, okay.
That's what we originally okay. worked to get, right. was a zero.
So the idea is if we added the capital debt service of $440,000, we would be looking at a small increase.
Yes.
Got it.
Yes.
0.21.
Right.
Mill rate, small. Some people may think that's big. But that, okay.
It's a 0.5%.
So I agree with everything you said.
Okay, so as a board, do we want to make a decision tonight if we do get a cut from where we are, from the original budgeted projected numbers? So if we get any kind of cut beyond what we have that's equal to or greater than that 440, that we definitely don't want to do any capital debt service next year. Everybody in agreement with that? We don't want to increase it. We're going to leave it at the $6.1 million.
Yeah, yeah.
We're not going to increase it.
Poor Lisa's having a heart attack over here.
No question. I'm having a hard time hearing, so I just want to make sure I understand. I don't want us to feel like if we have a dollar of revenue loss from the governor, that we therefore eliminate all capital. I mean, I think we have to combine them together so that the total impact is capped. Is that what you're saying, Barbara?
I didn't word it quite like that, but the way I worded it was, if the cut that comes from the state is more than the 440 that's on this chart, then we will not do the capital debt service increase at all.
As the cut, the state cuts get larger, the capital gets smaller. It's not a cliff. It's sort of an offset, right?
Maybe I can take one stab at this.
I'm just not looking at the same chart, since so this is difficult.
What would we do if the state cuts were $220,000? Then we would probably do $220,000 of capital. Is that what you're suggesting, Barb?
That's what I'm trying to say.
Right, we're combining the two.
So it doesn't have to be all or nothing.
So does that sound like everybody's agreeing to the... The 400.
That would. I guess what we're saying is that we think there's a tolerance for 0.21 mill rate or a 0.6% increase in taxes.
But no more.
And that's for the.
It's for whatever it's needed for.
Right, and that's equivalent to the 440.
Right, and if the governor were to cut the 600 that we started with, that we would take that 440
completely off.
Yep.
Right, and then what's left is the 200.
Which brings me all the way around to where I started, which
is that
doesn't feel really right to me unless we at least get some cost reductions out of the $97 million budget.
Is it 200 or is it 160?
What?
200 or 160?
Well,
if the governor cuts 600.
Yeah, we don't know.
Yeah,
you're right.
All I suggested at the beginning, and I'll say it again, is that
the pain.
Yes, and the process is going to be that when we get together again, there's going to be a public hearing, and we're going to approve a budget that goes to referendum. And at that budget, at that meeting, if the Board of Ed or the Board of Selectmen haven't identified some cuts, then we're just going to take the money away. I'm a rookie here, so tell me if
we can do that. We can just take it off the bottom line and put a budget forward for that much less. It can be done.
Okay.
But it would be preferable if
the public knew what the impact was and what was going to be cut.
Right.
And that's why it's better to provide clarity tonight and the recommendation to go back. And it sounds to me that everybody's pretty comfortable not thinking about the million and thinking about only 600 of it. Because if that's the case, then I think the numbers we're looking at are 150,000 and 50,000. And what would that mean? So if at the next hearing they could each come forward and tell us, that would be really helpful. And maybe you'll be lucky and we won't get anything cut and you can come and tell us that.
In which event we dedicate money to the
So is everybody clear what we're asking for?
Yes.
Absolutely.
So you're asking for us to come with a cut list of 50,000 from the operating budget?
For the Board of Selectmen.
For the Board of Selectmen. That's it for right now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And we ask you to relook at your capital list, to prioritize it between this year and next year, because while we will do what we can creatively to do the right projects, we just want everyone to know that there is an affordability issue in what's in front of us. And if there's something on this year's list that could be delayed for 5 years, you might want to do that so you can have more of what's on next year's list.
Have a conversation with staff.
Right. And then at the next hearing, if there are projects you're willing to take off this year's list, just move them to next year's for now, so they're in next year's conversation. Let us know, because we'll need that to go forward. Because the way it's working, the very next day, we need to provide the notice to the paper for the voters for the referendum. And so that will need to include the capital. So if it happens to be any of the capital projects, we need to know that. As far as which department, we do publish notice at a department level, don't we? So we'd like to know what department it's coming out of, if you can provide that. That's the 50 for you and the 150 for Board of Ed. Okay. Is there anything else on these items that we'd like to make sure? And before you go out, will you be available by phone when you're out of the country?
I will try.
Okay. Well, I didn't mean for the meeting. I just meant so we can get your input and
sure
you're heard
absolutely.
Before.
Yeah, absolutely.
Look at the meeting, too. You're welcome.
If you have your phone with you and it's on, we can track where you are.
That's good. You can actually get it. We don't have the money for that type of thing.
The capital. Yep. The turf and what else?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Lisa, did you want to say one more thing?
Just a clarification as to when you need that recommendation by date.
At our next meeting.
So, and that is?
We set it tentatively. We sent it tentatively for the 18th.
So I have some time.
But if the governor if everybody were to decide things tomorrow, we're going to try and meet as quickly as we can. So we would appreciate it if you would pay attention to that.
Yes.
Just because we don't want to move the referendum any further out than we have to.
You also have to make sure Moira and or Kevin are available that night.
Yes, we do. Okay, so there are two more items that I wanted to share with the board tonight, and it's about how we're building things in the budget. The first one is for OPEB. Last year, the actuaries that analyzed the funding came forward and told us on the OPEB fund they wanted us to use the same interest rate assumption that we use on all the other pension funds, and they were uncomfortable that we had two different assumptions. We have 7.5, it's historically what it was for OPEB, and we've taken the other pensions down to a 7% reinvestment rate assumption. They came back again this year and said, we really advise you for planning purposes to take it down to the 7%. I recommend to the board that we agree with that and that they should include the line item at a 7% assumption in there, and it just gives us the same reinvestment rate across all of our pension plans and the OPEB plan also.
What's that do to the budget though?
Nothing. They can accommodate it within the existing budget. Right?
Yep.
Will you can accommodate that? Okay. So
it uses up his extra. Remember he told you right. He had some extra. It uses up some of it. Most of it, to tell you the truth, between that and you had 12,000 you were funding for the other position.
I think we had said 8 and the town 12.
Eight, okay.
Assistant engineer position.
Right.
On our side, on the town side, it is in line with what we were expecting in the budget.
Right. Sure.
Right. All right, I'll move.
We would have a modest decrease in the operating budget.
So we're going to approve that?
Yeah,
I'll move that we reduce the reinvestment rate for OPEB assumptions to 7%, consistent with the pension.
I'll second that. I did have one question, though, which is, I understand it can be absorbed, so that means it'll be funded at a higher rate, and therefore it will not have an adverse impact on the percent of what's funded and not funded. It'll remain stable, correct? So we talk about our pension obligations and our post-employment benefit right. obligations and the percent at which we're funded, actuarially, that will remain the same.
Yeah, we'll still be funding our full
ARC. We would meet the ARC.
Right.
Okay.
But the ARC will be higher because we're going to a lower
right.
reinvestment rate. So it's going to require a little bit more funding up front.
Right.
And then depending on we need that motion. As you know, the open numbers have been somewhat delayed. Part of it is like a cart and a horse issue. We need that. The actuary is insisting on that change before the numbers are finalized.
But we could say no. It is our decision right. to make, but mm-hmm. I believe it's wise to lower.
It's fine.
And at the time, our OPEB was below the town one, and the actuaries argued with us when we tried to lower it to 7, and they told us we shouldn't. So that was part of why.
Right.
Right. That's part of why we got pushed back to them when they wanted us yeah. to take the small one down to that. Linda, are you following in? Because we have a motion on the table and a second. Are you have any questions?
Linda?
She might have muted. Or she's gone.
Is this connected there? Connection failed right now.
She hung up.
She may have hung up. We can call her back.
Did you dial? Just hit redial?
Is there a redial button?
Well, I don't think that we need a motion for it to go into the budget, so it doesn't matter if we don't have a quorum. If
I
Linda's not.
Okay.
So we don't have a quorum and we can't do a motion and a vote, but that's okay.
That's good enough.
We have direction for the budget, and that's really what they need. There's one more thing that I do need for them, and that is for the Board of Ed. I saw they all. Oh, not everyone though. For the Board of Ed, they do have a challenge with one project, and by us extending what they would normally do is after there's a vote and they're confident a project's been approved, they would then be able to start to issue some orders and get things started. The the turf field that they mentioned to us has some priority to get done over the summer because they can't do it in the fall when they need to play on the fields. And so they need to get some orders out. And I thought a possibility for us to help them make sure that we don't hold that up, because that's not a project that we're questioning in any way at all, was to make a commitment from this board that we would pay it out of cash reserves if for whatever reason we don't get the budget approved. We've got a commitment one way or another. It will still go into the budget. It will be part of the budget process. We're not shortcutting any of that, but we're just giving them permission to get it started early and guarantee them that if something happens, we will agree to approve that out of reserves if we need to, out of cash.
So that would be separate from the money that we've already approved for other items, or in lieu of?
Not going to come out of the 16 budget. It's still going to be a 17 budget.
Exactly.
We're just giving them strong assurance that we will approve it and fund it when they get, so they're going to get started.
Okay.
Right.
And my recollection is it's under the amount, right, that is
needed
for...
Yeah, it's not a listed project.
Right.
Okay. I'm comfortable.
I'm fine with that.
Okay, Linda? Oh, no, Linda. Okay, so you have three of us. I'm pretty sure, I talked to Linda about it before, and she was... in agreement at that point. So we don't have a vote or anything, Burke, but I assume that's all you need to be comfortable.
You gonna write it, Jack?
I'm good for now. Thank you.
You're
appreciate
good?
It. Yeah.
Okay. Is there anything else that we don't want to forget tonight?
Just a point of order. I don't know. Did you guys make a motion to set the next hearing date?
No motion.
I think that's a good point, Joan. The question is, if you haven't made a motion, then you have, after the hearing date, you have to hold the referendum within a certain amount of days. Is that right? As it was described to us. So do you need to get Linda on the phone and make a motion to set the next hearing date?
Yeah, we did not. I don't think we moved to set the hearing date.
I'll hijack your meeting for a moment while you dial. Today is Lisa's birthday. So we're going to embarrass Lisa while we're dialing Linda's number and give her some free cake. She needs it. She likes
the cake.
Lots of chocolate.
Yay, you're back.
Oh, thank goodness we got you. First of all,
happy birthday.
Major developments. We've got yet another milestone here.
We passed
today.
The budget.
We passed the budget, well, in your absence. And it's someone's birthday today, so I think we're all going to sing happy birthday.
I think that's
it completely embarrass our first select
woman.
Can we do that? Okay.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Lisa. Happy birthday to you.
Okay, an unusual part of a Board of Finance meeting, but happy birthday, Lisa.
Thank you.
So, Linda, we just wanted to make a motion officially on the record to set the next public hearing and Board of Finance date. It may get rescheduled. I just want to let people know that. But what we're setting it for tonight, and we're taking a vote on it, is for Wednesday, May 18th, to begin at 5:45.
That works. Can you call it a final public hearing? If you label it that, so the charter specifies it needs to be called a final public hearing.
Okay, it will be our final public hearing.
Intended to be the final public hearing.
That assumes the budget passes, because there's always another one possible.
So I move
but it was our intended final.
The final public hearing scheduled for May 18th at 5:45. And do we also need to move on the June 7th, or is that all separate?
Let's do one separate.
That would happen later. And actually, right. the date is set by the Board of Selectmen. The referendum date is actually established by the Board.
So I'd be usurping their authority.
Okay, so we have a motion. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay, all those in favor of setting that date for the next public, the final public hearing for us?
Aye.
Linda?
Aye.
Okay, I'm in favor too, so that was unanimous. And then Linda, just to give you a quick update, when we lost you, we talked about a commitment that we would make to the Board of Ed regarding the turf project, that if for any reason the budgets didn't move forward the way everybody's anticipating, we would find a way to fund that from cash out of next year's money if in fact there's any kind of problem, just so they can get started on it.
Summer. Right, there's timing issues. But where did I sort of disappeared. I'm not sure why, because it's still my phone showed I was connected. But where did we leave it with the issue of the, you know, if the governor cut, what do we do about capital? Did we decide not to decide, or?
Oh, you got cut off earlier than we thought.
Oh my gosh. That was a long time ago. What?
I know. I've been sitting here waiting. So
I think it's fair to say, I'll try to summarize that we concluded that we would go with the 440,000 number and
as a maximum tax increase to taxpayers.
Correct.
And that we would ask the Board of Selectmen and the Board of Ed to find, respectively, $50,000 and $150,000 out of their budgets so that they would contribute, and that would cover a cut of somewhere in the $660,000 range. If the cut's bigger than that, I think we're gonna have to find a way to take care of it and smooth it in.
That was so fluid, you can't figure it out.
Okay.
Okay?
Yep.
Anything else for tonight? Okay, hearing nothing.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Right, see
this
you,
time,
Linda.
Goodbye, Linda.
Thanks, Linda.
Take care. See you.